How did the Federalists respond to the Anti-Federalist fears about a large republic?
The response is in Madison's Federalist 10. Madison knows, because Brutus's essay came out a few weeks earlier, that he's got to answer this key question, which is, how can people's liberty be preserved in a republic as large as the United States and as diverse as the United States? And what Madison does is he turns the argument on its head, and he says that a republic will in fact work best in a large, diverse nation. And here's how he does it. Madison begins Federalist 10 like this. Among the numerous advantages promised by a well-constructed union, none deserves to be more accurately developed than its tendency to break and control the violence of faction. In other words, Madison seems in Federalist 10 to be talking about the problems of factions, and he defines a faction as any group within a society, whether they are a majority or a minority of that society, who possess some kind of interest or passion that is antithetical to the larger public good. So what he's saying is, what a well-constructed union needs to do is to break and control the violence of factions. What kind of union can best do that? So Madison says there are two ways that you can break or control factional violence. They are to remove the causes of faction or to control the effects of faction. And then he goes on to explain each of those. How can you remove the causes of faction? Well, what causes factions? Factions might be caused by the fact that people are different from each other, the fact that they have different ideas and different views, because they are free to have different ideas and different views. So to remove the cause of faction, you could simply destroy people's liberty. You could destroy their liberty to disagree and to have their own interests. But Madison then says, that's a solution that's worse than the disease. You're destroying the very liberty that we are trying to protect. So you can't remove the causes of faction by destroying people's liberty. He also says the other way to remove the causes of faction is to give everybody the same opinions. But that will never happen. He says, as long as men are fallible, which is a very interesting word to use there, as long as he's suggesting men can get things wrong, they're going to have different opinions. But then he goes on to say that there are lots of other reasons that people have different opinions, whether it has to do with religion, whether it has to do with politics, and especially whether it has to do with economics. And he explains and emphasizes that the deepest causes of factions are economic causes. Some people are creditors, some people are debtors, some people are buyers, some people are sellers, and so on. So what he's saying is, you can't remove the causes of faction. You'll either be destroying people's liberty, which is a terrible thing, it's worse than the disease, or you have the problem of giving people the same opinions, which can't happen. So he says, you've got to control the effects of faction. The only way to break and control the violence of faction is to control its effects. What kinds of factions could we have? We could have a minority faction, that is, a faction that represents a small minority within a particular society, and that's no problem, because that kind of faction will get outvoted. The real problem is what Madison calls the majority faction. What happens when the majority of people in a society are trying to make something happen that is in opposition to the greater good of that society? For example, what happens when debtors within a society, who might be the majority of the farmers, so a majority of the voters, take control and they try to overturn fundamental ideas, fundamental social goods about credit and debt? Madison is most worried about the problems of a majority faction because they have the power to win at the ballot box. So here's the problem, according to Madison. We need to secure the public good and private rights. That is, the greater good of the public and the rights of individual citizens. What's the best way to do that if you should have a majority faction that is either campaigning against what is truly the public good or is trying to take away the private rights of some minority. Well, will a democracy solve the problem? No, a democracy is exactly what you don't need. In a democracy, the majority will rule, and so a majority faction will undermine the public good or private rights. So you need to have a republic. A republic could help because people vote for representatives. They aren't directly voting. A majority isn't directly voting. And then Madison explains what he thinks happens in a republic. That is, representatives, in his words, refine and enlarge the public views. His vision, in other words, is that representatives will not simply mirror or reflect their constituents' views, but take a bigger view, take a broader view, refine and enlarge ordinary citizens' views. Think about the greater good. Now, what kind of republic is most likely to create that kind of representative? What about the small republic, the great classical republic that anti-federalists so prized? What will happen in a small republic? Madison says that a small republic will not solve the problem. Why? Because let's say you have a republic with 100 citizens. You'll probably have fewer factions. There won't be citizens going each of six or eight different ways, which means there's actually more chance of a majority faction taking control in a small republic. In other words, if you have fewer people, there's more chance that bad people will win. What about a large republic? What about, Madison might say, a republic as big as the United States? First of all, according to Madison, you'll have more citizens per representative. Remember, this is what the anti-federalists hate. The anti-federalists say 40,000 citizens per member of the House of Representatives, that representative can't possibly know his constituents' minds. Madison says, actually, that's a good thing. Why? First of all, it's a lot harder for bad people to win elections by bribery if they've got 40,000 constituents than if they've got a few hundred. So artful politicians are less able to practice their arts, say, by bribing people. So Madison argues that in a large republic, it's hard for bad people to get elected because they have so many more constituents to persuade. And it's also much harder for any single faction to win a nationwide majority. If you imagine a nation that stretches all the way from New Hampshire to Georgia, will a conflagration that erupts in New Hampshire really spread all the way to Georgia? Madison says that's much less likely than a revolt, say, just in one state, taking over the state. He also suggests that if somebody gets elected to do bad things in one part of the nation, it's unlikely that he will be followed by people far away because he's not likely to know the people from far away well enough to be able to go up to them and say, "Can we collude in this?" You're more likely to collude with people you know. So the larger the nation is, in fact, the less likely it is for any one faction to win a majority. And that's why, Madison argues, a large republic will in fact do a better job of breaking and controlling the violence of faction than a small republic. And so what seems like an essay that's about factions is really an essay about large republics and why they are the best protectors of the people's liberty. He has, in effect, answered Brutus and answered the anti-federalists by saying the larger the republic, the more chance there is of protecting people's liberty.
So I have to ask, to what extent, if any, is there evidence that these arguments are valid today with respect to the U.S.?
Madison, in some ways, has proven quite right about the value of diversity for not preventing faction, but at least checking the violence of faction, but not in the way he expected. So Madison would have thought the development of political parties was evidence of faction. But in fact, look at the parties we've got today. We have two large political parties inside each of those political parties are all sorts of different interests. If you look inside the Democrats or look inside the Republicans, you will see people with a variety of different views. Madison might argue, and at many points in our history, that has meant that the parties, neither party, can go all the way in one direction because they have plenty of people in the party who don't want to go as far as perhaps an extreme. So what we have is a system in which each of our political parties might serve to operate sort of like Madison's big republic. That is, each political party contains so many different pieces, so many different interests and ideas that neither one can work its will to undermine the people's liberty. What Madison could not have expected, or at least didn't expect in 1787, was the way in which changes in transportation and communication have really created a national citizenry and have made it possible for an idea that might start in Georgia to spread across the country to California and to Alaska and to anywhere else. And so Madison would probably have said that in his time, the fact that people were so far flung would make it hard for bad ideas to take over. Today, any ideas can get pretty much any place in the blink of an eye.